are certainly a time of centennial and bicentennial celebrations, which is a testament to the longstanding commitment of strong businesses and nonprofits in our community. Martin Library itself is one of our finest community organizations dedicated to providing learning and enrichment opportunities for people of all ages. I've had the privilege of serving on the board and in leadership capacity for both Martin and the York-North Library System for the past 16 years. And currently as chair of Martin Library. And in that time, I witnessed the scope and structure of the library consistently change and improve to meet the ever-increasing demands of an informed and eager-to-learn population. Most recently, Martin Library has undergone new leadership with the retirement of longtime President and CEO Bill Schell to the hiring of fellow Rotarian Robert Lambert, who prior to accepting his new role in June as President and CEO of Martin Library Association and the York County Library System, he served in many capacities as an employee of Martin for most of his life, over 20 years. Robert couldn't be here today as he is in Dillsburg engaged in an all-day town hall meeting, one of many with all of the member and branch libraries in an effort to build synergy and connections with libraries throughout our community. Our speaker today is Laura O'Grady, Director of Development for York County Libraries. She's a member of the Rotary Club of York-North and was a member of the 2014 group study exchange trip to Argentina, led by President Patty. You may recall that Laura shared her experiences with us after the group's return from Argentina. Laura holds a master's degree in library science and has been with the library since 2011. This year, Laura is leading the celebration of the 100th anniversary, an event that celebrates the founding and evolution of Martin Library. In the past 100 years, the library has transformed from a quiet gathering place to a multi-dimensional hands-on learning environment where anything is possible. From dance camps through Positive Energy Arts Foundation, founded by fellow Rotarian Bill Shipley and led by immediate past CEO Martin of YCLS, Bill Schell, to STEM learning and robust after-school programs at York City Schools. Martin's celebration theme is 100 Years Changes Everything, a change that would not have been possible without the steadfast support of our generous community and many of you who are here today who help provide knowledge for learning, answers for life. Please join me in welcoming Rotarian Laura O'Grady.
Among Carnegie's many quotable quotes, you'll find, In bestowing charity, the main consideration should be to help those who help themselves. Here you see members of one of Carnegie's first libraries doing just that. A 2013 article by Susan Stamberg states, Carnegie saw libraries as agents of change, not luxuries, but necessities, as crucial to the community as police, fire, and public schools. Locally, we were very lucky to have our own captain of industry looking out for the betterment of this community. Milton Mark was born in 1859 in Lower Windsor Township. Educated in public school, Martin found himself ill-equipped to be able to compete in business at a young age. Through the dogged pursuit of self-education and the support of his wife, Martha, Martin was able to establish the Martin Carriage Works in 1900. At its peak, the Martin Carriage Works was building 20,000 carriages per year. And at the same time, Martin also found time to establish the Guardian Trust Company, a building right across the street from where we stand today. The Guardian Trust Company was established as one of the foremost financial institutions in York. Upon his death in 1912, according to his wishes, $125,000 was dedicated to the establishment of a public library, with another $60,000 following the death of his wife and his mother. These funds would be invested with the income going toward establishing the public library. In 1916, 4 years after his death, the Martin Library Association was established, which is what we're celebrating this year. It was formed for the creation, support, maintenance, care, and management of a public library in the city of York for the free use of the people of York and the county of York without restrictions whatsoever on any kind of race, color, or religious beliefs. Again, I'd like to pause here and remark on how pioneering this was. Thinking of all our city, country, and world would go through in the next 100 years, these men and the vision of Milton Martin were truly ahead of their time. 4 years later, in 1920, a lot was identified and purchased for library construction. While Martin's request was generous, it was deemed woefully inadequate for the construction and maintenance of such an institution. A 1933 article in the Yorker assures the public that although the library project is taking longer than people would like, it is being handled very conscientiously, intentionally, and responsibly. Of the several ways by which city libraries come into existence, the author writes, the Martin Library will be a specimen of the best. As many of you are aware, major projects, sometimes at the mercy of public funds, take time. Finally, in 1934, the architect Frederick Dimple was hired and plans began, and construction began on the colonial style building you see today. And in a nationwide search, Catherine Shorey was hired as the first librarian, and in agreement with York City Schools, Jeanette Woolsey was hired as the children's librarian to organize and circulate books throughout the city school district. The library finally opened October 31st, 1935, with 22,000 items on their shelves. Accounts report that as it was Halloween, many children had their first visit in Halloween costumes. Overwhelmed by the number of visits on those first few days, Catherine Shorey was heard describing the scene as bedlam. And for any of you who have recently visited Martin Library Children's Room on a hot summer day, you know nothing has changed. Here you can see patrons utilizing the original main reading room with the tile floors that are no longer visible today, but the oak bookshelves which happily are. And here is a very cool graphic representation of the first 5 years of library services. I understand you won't be able to see very closely, but I'll highlight some points. I love this photo and impressed by how ahead of the time they were with the use of an infographic. You can see that by 1940, borrowers had increased to 28,000 with an average of 1,047 books checked out every day. From the outset, Martin Library was looking to continuously adapt to the needs of our and the interests of our community. They were experts in providing resources and they began to look beyond traditional bookbinding. By 1954, we had over 4,000 items in a record collection, including symphonies, concertos, operas, and foreign language instruction. We also recognize the need for services for differently abled individuals. Here you can see the ceiling projection service for bedridden patrons. This device projected an image of a page of a book on the ceiling over the bed of the patient. And as stated in the 1954 annual report, a flick of the thumb or chin or elbow or toe will ring the next page when the patient is ready for it. I think this original pictures for home use. But most importantly, and most fundamentally for the future of Marvin Library, we always recognize the importance of service to children. Carl Sagan once said, one of the greatest gifts we can give to parents can give to their offspring and their society is to read to children. We now know that literacy and the age in which children are exposed to early learning opportunities is a strong indicator of their success later in life. In 1955, because of a donation from the Baker family, the John E. Baker Children's Library was added to Marvin Library. John Baker was the first president of the Marvin Library Association and a constant champion of Milton Marvin's dream. Over the next 50 years, our library would see great change. In 1963, the Marvin Library became the district center for York and Adams County, and in 1974, the York County Library System was established. The creation of the library system allowed for the sharing of resources and a platform for advocacy that went beyond the local library. Over the years, our advocacy and awareness campaigns have taken many forms, but it usually involved costumes and balloons. Here you see poor kids that we got to dress up in books and jump and dance up and down the steps of the Capitol building. A visit from Yoda, which probably traumatized more than one child, implored us to read and the force would be with you. E.T. once visited to answer reference questions, and have even got librarians to dress up and exercise while on a parade float. You can see that the dancing books made an appearance here as well. But one thing that has always consisted in these photos, besides balloons and costumes, is smiling, happy people. We're so lucky to have a culture of support and engagement at Marvin Library. We all love what we do, and we'd love to tell you about it. This public awareness and support is what allowed us to complete two capital campaigns, one in 1985 and one in 2005. So from 1955 to 2005, Marvin Library Children's Area transformed from this to this to this. The capital campaign of 2005 was notable in many ways. Many of you here today play a part in this tremendous project. With the generous donation of the brownstone next door by Susquehanna Ballstraff, and with extensive community support, the library footprint was essentially doubled, seamlessly blending old and new to become an updated architectural gem of downtown York. And if Andrew Carnegie was the father of public libraries, Bill Gates was that cool uncle with all the new gadgets. In 1997, through the library's online initiative, the Microsoft Corporation donated $1 million to bring internet access to public libraries across the United States. Always quick to adapt to innovation, that same year, Marvin Library opened their first public access computer lab. In the year 2000, we established CyberCamp for kids, and over the past 16 years, our public access computing services have kept pace with industry trends and continues to be the cornerstone of library services today. In the United States, about a third of those aged 14 and older, roughly 77 million people, utilize a public library computer or wireless network to access the internet each year. As you can see, libraries are no stranger to change. The library is a growing organism. In the field of library science, there are five laws which guide the profession. The fifth law, and arguably the most important, implores the library to be a growing organism. As our world changes, so must the public library. The books only vision of the public library runs directly counter to the idea of libraries as agents of change. Today, Marvin Library continues to redefine ourselves with innovative programming and new technology. For example, our partnership with the York City police officers to hold monthly police gaming programs establishes a healthy and congenial relationship between our city's youth and law enforcement. The Martin Mechanics Robotics team opened up the world of competitive robotics to children who would normally be priced out for such an experience. Our focus on STEM programming through engineer week celebrations gives children hands-on experience to spark curiosity and ignite interest. And most recently, our partnership with the York County Prison to establish Beyond Our Walls, a program to connect incarcerated parents with their children through literacy, reminds me again of why I love my job. We're very grateful for the Literacy Committee of this Rotary Club, as well as the Black Health Insurance Group for making this program a reality. So we saw the numbers in 1940, let's look at last year. In 2015, we had 400,000 visits, 69,000 cardholders, 274,000 circulation of items, 163,000 PC uses, over 600 programs, and 862,000 minutes were read during the summer reading club. That's the equivalent of reading straight for a year and a half. So how are we celebrating this anniversary? We're going to have a party. A birthday party to be more specific. November 5th, we'll be having a birthday party in the children's room to mark the anniversary of the 100th anniversary of Martin Library Association. Milton's our little mascot, Milton the Bookworm, and he'll be up hand to have fun. If you have any little ones in your life, bring them down. We're going to have face painting and addition and crafts and cake and food and fun meals. So while a lot has changed since 1916, a lot does remain the same. We remain woven into the fabric of our community. We're committed to giving all children the best start in life. And as in Carnegie's vision, we remain dedicated to helping those who help themselves. In closing, I'd like to reflect with gratitude for these past 100 years, for Milton Martin, John Baker, and the countless others, many of whom are here today, for supporting Martin Libraries, past, present, and future. Thank you very much.
Yes.
here? No, I don't, correct me if I'm wrong, not that I know of. I went to library school in New York, and there was an extensive amount of Carnegie money in the New York libraries, but as far as I know, it didn't come here during this time. The Carnegie Foundation still does